said, take up that, okay? So I can't stand up here and read it all to you, but a couple of quick things. The folks that are on the vision action team, really get down and pay attention to that and know what's going on. Pastor Lisa's study of Mark recently started, and she said to remind you, it's not too late to jump in the pool, okay? Discovery Weekend is going to be here in about a month. There's more information for that here. Discovery Weekend is a spiritual formation retreat for our middle school students led by the high school students. So this is a wonderful mission, and we pray for participation on every level. Please silence your phones so you don't get embarrassed. And let us know that you were here by signing on that attendance register. And I think it's time to move into worship. What do y'all think?
We already worshiped.
Yes, ma'am.
They didn't.
I have to say, yes, ma'am, a lot, really.
You're well trained.
I do want you to know, I want all of us to be connected to our Creator and God the Father, because we are so special to Him. It's just almost beyond description. So let's have a moment of quiet reflection, each in our own way, and we'll ask our Creator God to be with us. Almighty God, we come together to praise you, lift our voices to you. We pray that this whole entire service be acceptable and pleasing to you. We thank you that you have given us this wonderful place where we can come on a regular basis and worship you without being in fear. Lord, there's so many people everywhere else, other places where it's not even a possibility. We thank you for your son Jesus and the message of the cross. We thank you for our wonderful choir and the leadership. We thank you for our pastor and her leadership. And we pray that the message that we hear today is exactly the right message for us this morning. We lift all of our prayers in the holy and precious name of your Son and our Savior, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Let's stand and sing our opening hymn, number 733, We're Marching to Zion.
Thank you. expectations and hopes and dreams and sorrows and losses. And God meets us right where we are. And then we gather and we begin to sing and pray together. And the Spirit is with us. Always, always. It's a matter of if we can slow down enough to hear it. But surely in this place, we can. And as we enter into this time of prayer, I just invite you to settle your heart and mind. Be still and know that God is with us. Let us pray. God, it is so hard to be still. For our minds range this way and that. Our hearts are pulling and tugging us into things that we rightfully so have concern over. And yet you continue to call us and to beckon us into your presence. And as we come sometimes reluctantly and sometimes with open arms. Receive us just as we are, Lord. And even in that, we recognize your power that is offered out. So God, today, as we come to worship, we ask you to hear our prayers, the ones that are silent upon our heart. And now as we lift up names of those we wish to ask your blessing upon. Making room for healing and hope. And yes, Lord, in all those things, we trust you. And so we deem that this time is time for you to speak to our spirit. So give us a stillness that opens our heart and mind to you. And even as we pray for ourselves, we pray for others. We pray for this community and for the ways in which we have yet to understand how we can reach out in your love. And then, Lord, we pray for this world. And we ask, God, that you would continue to make disciples and that you would make hearts ready. And make us ready, Lord. For we are your people and we want to follow you. We ask you to hear us as we join together in one sacred prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And I invite our ushers to come forward and ask. in the lives and in the days of Jesus. And this speaks to us powerfully because there is this dual nature of our relationship with God, isn't it? It's the one that we perceive and the one that we long and hope for in eternity. And that's just where that music brought me, is to that place of full worship. Thank you. Thank you. And I just have to say, what a blessing it is to worship with you. And what it means to be humbly serving with you. And what a joy it is to be in this community. And together, these worship moments plant things in us that they retain our spirit in ways that God intends for us to be retained. I was already praising God this morning before I heard that song about just the blessing of being with you all in worship. And now we have this lesson that is out of God's word. I'll be reading to you from Luke chapter 6, beginning with the 17th verse. I think you're familiar with it, and if you're like me, when I read it the first time, I sort of transliterated it into the Matthew. But I want us to read it carefully as the way that Luke presents Jesus' sermon here as he speaks to the people. So if you will, stand as you are able as I read to you from God's word. He came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all the crowd were trying to touch him, for power came out from him and healed all of them. Then he looked up at his disciples and said, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you, and when they exclude you, and revile you, and defame you on account of the Son of Man. Rejoice in that day and leap for joy, for surely your reward is great in heaven, for that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received your consolation. Woe to you who are full now, for you will be hungry. Woe to you who are laughing now, for you will mourn and weep. Woe to you when all speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the false prophets." The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Let us pray. God, you have given us your word and your teachings. Allow us, Lord, to join you on the plain, up in our hearts and our minds to your word. And Lord, let us be blessed in the hearing. And all of God's people said, amen. Well, the first thing that I did as I read this was unintentionally, I said, oh yeah, this is the Sermon on the Mount. How many of you all thought that? A few. Yes, thank you. The fact is, this is a different presentation of a very important teaching. And it's natural that we would overlay many stories, but we need to come into this, and I will give a little add-on. This is part of what we are doing in our study of Mark, is learning to read specifically from the book that we're reading so that we get the clear intent and meaning of that particular writer. In this one, we have a total, I call it a switcheroo, right? We heard this story one way, but we're reading it a fresh way. And it's really important because it's something I never picked up on in the strength that it came to me this time, that Jesus was on a plane. And that the people all around him were looking for a blessing. And we use
blessing so frequently, don't we? Somebody sneezes, bless you. Somebody is celebrating something, well, praise God, bless you. I am so glad that happened for you. We use it in so many ways. But in this context, we are speaking of how people are going to Jesus and they are seeking a blessing that will allow them to experience the power of God and feel fulfilled in the presence of God. This is a whole different realm of blessing, isn't it? It's about the relationship that we seek in the presence of God. And they're listening and waiting for Jesus to bless them. And it reaches to their very soul. It's not just, and I don't mean this lightly, not just a healing. It's about a blessing that fulfills them in a spiritual way, that moves them to a fresh relationship with God. And don't we hunger and thirst after that? These people that came had brokenness in their lives, but they had brokenness in their spirit. When I think about how Jesus healed them, in a way, we become companions with our brokenness, don't we? We begin to understand that as part of who we are. It sort of defines us in our own mind and in our community, too, sometimes. And that kind of identity is being removed by these people. Someone who could not walk was walking. Someone who could not see was seeing. Someone who could not hear was hearing. And the list goes on. Excuse me. So, in a way, when you think about it, and Jesus is on this plane, and all these people have felt the power of Jesus, they've been healed. And they are in a new place. But you don't hear that they're leaving, do you? They're still waiting. They're waiting to hear the teaching that empowers them and fills them to go forward in their world as they are now. You see, we have to understand who we are after Jesus has touched us, don't we? And so, we get this image of Jesus on a plane. Now, the first thing is, when you think about being on a plane, we don't talk in that language much, but if I said mountain, you'd say, oh yeah. But when we're on a plane, it's a level place. It's very flat. It's not necessarily conducive to seeing others, is it? You see the tops of heads and the tall people. And you see the people right in front of you, but there are limitations. The meaning for plane in the New Testament gives me a fresh insight this reading. Never picked up on it before. And I credit a commentator, Ronald J. Allen, for this. He says that the plane that is being described is a state of place, emotionally as well as physically. Often when you read about a plane in the New Testament and even in the Old, it's associated with mourning, with corpses, with suffering. I never thought that way before. And this is due to the richness of God's word, isn't it? That we would encounter Jesus who has intentionally now, he has intentionally set himself in a place of brokenness, a place where he's meeting people who are broken. And how does that change our experience of who Jesus is? It says to me, and I pray God is revealing all new insight to you too, but that when Jesus has come into the level place of brokenness with us, Jesus is not separating or looking down upon me, and Jesus is not looking up and making me feel shame that I have put him in that lower place in my life. But Jesus is on the plane with us, with me, with you, in this place. And that
Jesus allows the realm of God, the kingdom of God is a more familiar way of thinking of it, the realm of God coming near. Over and again in the New Testament, we hear Jesus say that the kingdom of God is near. And in this experience, the kingdom of God is near. The people are experiencing the life-giving work of God, physically, spiritually, and Jesus looks upon them and understands that they have this place of need to understand how to live into this new blessing. What does it mean? Because you see, their whole lives have turned for them. Something that they understood about themselves has been taken. It has been healed, removed. They have been given a freedom they never dreamed they would have. We too come to Jesus, sometimes believing that we will never be free of the bondage that we carry, of the brokenness, of the hurt, of the stories of our life that have shaped us and turned us, and we cannot imagine that God would touch us with this kind of healing. But God promises to give us a blessing, to lead us where we are. And so Jesus looks upon them, and I believe he looks upon us, and he knows that what we really, really need is some plain talk. Not some highfalutin, high-speaking, theological information that people go home and wonder about for the rest of their lives. He speaks plainly. And he tells them what it is to be in the realm of God and what you will miss if you are not a part of that. Let me read it to you again. He says, "Blessed are you who are poor, for yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, for you will be filled. Blessed are you who will weep, for you will laugh. Blessed are you when people hate you and revile you, and when they exclude you and defame you on account of the Son of Man." He says, "Rejoice in that day and leap for joy. For surely your reward is great in heaven." And the people listening understand. Because there are poor among them. Because even though they're poor in that day and that moment, they have experienced the realm of God. And that they can indeed experience the kingdom of God because they're poor. And the ones who are hungry, they know that Jesus is talking about more than the belly. He's talking about the spirit. And they look at one another and they realize that they are in the midst of experiencing the fullness of God. And those who have wept and sorrowed and grieved have felt the touch of God in their heart. And even though the sorrow is real, the joy has been washed over by the realm, the presence of God, the kingdom of God given to them. And then Jesus turns the tables, and this is where he says the plain-spoken woes, right? Oh, this is Bob. It's always bothered me that when I get to this point, I get uncomfortable. You know, when scripture makes you uncomfortable, you best Is he talking about my belly? Maybe. But even more than that, is he speaking to my spirit? And woe to you who are laughing, for you will mourn and weep. And woe when people speak well of you, for that is what their ancestors did to the prophets. Folks, I don't like that woe part. I just read it and went, ouch! Are you talking to me? Am I part of this woe group that is stuck? And then the question is, does he mean it's a sin to be rich and to have food? And does it mean that it's wonderful to be full of laughter, but it's a sin? Let's press on a little bit. I trust that the God of our very creation, who gives us so much in our lives, is not calling it sin. But what he is asking those who have more, and this is consistent with Jesus throughout his ministry, if you have more, share what you have with who have less. But you see, in this talking to the people, the ones who came that were wealthy and rich and not hungry, never before had they considered it to be part of their responsibility to bring the kingdom of God through their blessings to others. This was radical, folks. We're not talking socialism here. We're talking spiritualism. We're talking about the fact that when Jesus blesses, and he doesn't curse, he just tells them, whoa. And I mean whoa. Sackcloth and ashes, God, I'm sorry and I repent. He is saying to us that these are the things that will pull you away from the presence of God. If you do not release these things, if you love these things more than you love me, you cannot be a part of the kingdom of God, because it has to be God first. Excuse me. In this message is a message to the heart. I'll let you decide if it's yours. I know it's mine. The message is to love God above all things. And that comes first and foremost. We cannot let the wealth of our lives, the blessings of things that we have, get in the way of the love of God being our primary focus to shape us and to mold us. We cannot let the fullness of our stomach and of our lives, folks. Our lives are filled to overflowing sometimes, and there's just no room for Jesus. Jesus saw. I want to be fully present, even though I have received many woeful blessings. I want Jesus to help me order them in ways that bring the kingdom of God to others. And I want to live in a world where I do not look down or let others put me down, but be joyful in the name of the Lord and all that is done. For you see, we can let the world form us, or we can let the Word form us. On this day when Jesus has healed and blessed, when the power has gone out, may the power go out amongst us today. And may we, as the people on the plains, be the ones who see the world through Christ's eyes.